Welcome back to the narration of those 18 days, life lessons from the 18 days of the Kurukshetra war. Today, we'll discuss about the dramatic events that happened on the 18th day, half time, that is the 9th day. Things started heating up, especially from this day onward. So Bhima had been working havoc in the Kaurava camp and he had bested Duryodhan several times. On the 8th evening, there was a fierce battle in which Bhima completely defeated Duryodhan and he was reduced to a helpless state of being wounded physically and being wounded at the level of his pride and ego, and distraught and enraged, he ranted on about how he felt that his defeat was because Bhishma was not fighting wholeheartedly. Although it was Bhima who had defeated him, he felt that the war had still been going on because Bhishma was not fighting to his full extent. And when he met Karna, who was sitting out of the fight as long as Bhishma was fighting, Karna said, "Just get me on the battlefield and I will win the war for you soon." Duryodhan took a deep breath and then he went to Bhishma and he told him, "Oh grandsire, just see how under your commandership our army is being destroyed. Even I myself lay wounded. I do not believe that you are incapable of defeating the Pandava army. When you have defeated even the one who defeated all Kshatriyas, Parshuram. If, oh father," he looked down and looked up straight into Duryodhana, into Bhishma's eyes, and he said, "Oh grandsire, if out of affection for the Pandavas, you are not ready to fight wholeheartedly, then kindly step down and let Karna become the commander and he will do for me what you are unwilling to do." Bhishma felt the dagger of Duryodhana's words pierce deep into his heart. For honorable Kshatriya, even the insinuation that he was not fighting properly was unbearable. What to speak of an open accusation? Bhishma tried to control the anger within him. It was raging through at this insolent son of Duryodhana, of Dhritarashtra, Duryodhana. So he told, "Oh prince, I have told you again and again why the Pandavas can't be defeated. Because they have Krishna with him, with them. I have exerted myself to my fullest capacity. My body bears wounds because of what I am trying to do for you. What more do you think that the son of Suta can do? Yet, because you have impugned my honor, I take a vow now. Tomorrow, I will use these 5 arrows and kill the 5 Pandavas with them." And he closed his eyes, went into a mystic trance, and the 5 arrows he had selected from his quiver, they looked powerful and fearsome, and he invested them with further mystic power. And Duryodhana was delighted. And then he said, "Oh grandsire, let me keep these arrows with me. And I'll give them to you tomorrow." He wanted to make sure that nothing went wrong. However, his keeping the arrows itself was what went wrong. Krishna is omniscient, and Krishna told Arjuna, "Today you have something to do even after the day's fight is over." So it's like Arjuna has to work overtime. "Oh, okay." So he said, "Go to Duryodhan and ask him for the 5 arrows. Long ago, when Duryodhana had been arrested by the Gandharvas, Arjuna and Bhima together had defeated the Gandharvas and released Duryodhana. At that time, although Duryodhana had felt humiliated at having been arrested and then at having been rescued by his rivals, but still out of Kshatriya honor, he said, "You have done me a favor, so I wish to grant you a boon." So Arjuna had said, "I don't want anything now. Maybe in future I'll ask you." So Krishna told him, "You remember that boon now?" So Arjuna was surprised. He said, "Yes, he has got five arrows, which Bhishma has invested mystic power. And you go and ask for those arrows." When Arjuna went to meet Duryodhan, Duryodhan was surprised and he said, "Oh Arjuna, what do you want? Welcome to my tent. If you want the kingdom, I'll give it to you right now." Now, Duryodhan was being facetious because he knew Arjuna as a Kshatriya would never ask for a kingdom. He said that, "I want the five arrows." So Duryodhana was shocked. Yet out of a sense of honor, he gave those arrows and he said, as Arjuna was departing, "Who told you about the arrows?" Duryodhana had kept that information top secret. He had sent all the spies and others away while he was having that conversation. He was sent all attendants away while he was having that conversation with Bhishma. Said, "How did you know?" And Arjuna, just looking back at his smile, and said, "Krishna told me." Duryodhana pounded his fist in his hand. He said, "Krishna, how does he know everything? Is he God?" Exasperated, he fell into fitful sleep. Next morning, when Bhishma asked Duryodhan for those five arrows, Duryodhan shamefacedly told him what had happened. Bhishma smiled. Bhishma knew, in fact, when he had taken the vow the previous day, that Krishna would do something to protect his devotees. So, in fact, he had taken that vow with the express purpose of wanting to discover what Krishna does to protect his devotees. So he was delighted to see the ingenuity of Krishna, and he told Duryodhana that, "I had used much of my mystic power to invest in those arrows. I cannot do it again. But still, I will fight fiercely. And today, I will kill Arjuna unless Krishna intervenes to protect him." Duryodhana's spirits, which had drooped at the loss of the five arrows, now became ascendant once again. And he told his warriors, "Guard the grandsire as he launches what could be a lethal attack on Arjuna." And Bhishma swooped on the Pandava forces and started destroying them. Seeing the utter ruination that he was causing, Arjuna came forward. Although there had been some encounters between Arjuna and Bhishma, Arjuna's heart was not really in the fight. And he had fought, but he had kept the fighting to some extent minimal. So Arjuna moved forward to fight with Bhishma, but even now his heart was not in it. Bhishma was fighting with full ferocity because he was eager to see how Krishna would intervene to protect Arjuna. And Arjuna was fighting half-heartedly because his affection and reverence for his grandsire was stopping him from fighting. And thus, it was a mismatch. Emotions are facts of life, and they are not just facts, they are very powerful facts of life. We sometimes say that, we need to judge rationally, not get carried away by our emotions, and that is true. At the same time, while we don't want to be carried away by our emotions, we are usually carried by our emotions. It's like emotions are the way, are the sea in which we are floating. So sometimes the sea may contain currents which sweep us away in an unwanted direction, But sometimes the currents can sweep us in the wanted direction also. So while we can try to be emotionally equipoised, but if we want to do something worthwhile, we need to channel the power of emotion, not curb that power. Because if we simply are focused on curbing the power of emotion, then we lose what is a very empowering resource for ourselves. Those who achieve something, anything worthwhile, they have a deep passion. Passion here is used in a positive sense of great attraction, great drive, great determination for that particular area in life. So now, of course, circumstantially, some emotions may come and go and they may have to resist them. But at a deep driving and sustaining level, even defining level, they have a passion, which is an emotion that pushes them through various obstacles. So now, in this case, Bhishma and Arjuna both had a passion for archery, for martial expertise. They were Kshatriyas, and that was their duty as well as their passion. That's how they had risen to such enormous levels of accomplishment. However, in this particular war, Arjuna's emotion was impeding him because of his affection for Bhishma. And Bhishma's emotion was empowering him because he was eager, based on his devotional aspiration, to see how Krishna would protect his devotee. And Bhishma was anyway a formidable warrior, and Arjuna at his best would have had to exert to even equal Bhishma, what to speak of, to exceed Bhishma. But a half-hearted Arjuna with a whole-hearted Bhishma was just no match. And Bhishma was destroying the Pandava forces who were supporting Arjuna, while at the same time wounding Arjuna severely also. And while Arjuna was fighting, but his heart was not in it. And he was being wounded, but still he couldn't bring himself to fully, with full force, attack Bhishma. Seeing this, Krishna became pensive. He was astonished and alarmed to see Bhishma's speed, skill, and strength. And he recognized that within a short time, not only could the Pandava army be destroyed, but even Arjuna himself might be killed if Bhishma were not checked. And seeing that Arjuna was not ready for the task of checking Bhishma, Krishna decided to take things in his own hands. Literally. In his hands, the reins of Arjuna's chariot had been there, and Krishna had taken a vow that he would only be a non-combatant in this war. But for him, more important than his word of honor was his love for his devotee. And thus, while on the chariot, he looked around and he saw a weapon. Actually, he saw a wheel of a broken chariot. And that, at one level, subconsciously reminded him of his own Sudarshan Chakra, which is his weapon. The Lord is such a person that he can neutralize even the most powerful weapons. And he can weaponize even the most ordinary objects. Normally, a wheel wouldn't be considered to be a weapon, but the Lord's Sudarshan Chakra is the most unstoppable of all weapons. And Krishna here was filled with so much anxiety for Arjuna that he didn't think of summoning the Sudarshan Chakra. He jumped off his chariot and raced across the field and picked up that wheel. And raising that wheel aloft, he started racing toward Bhishma. And he roared to Bhishma, "You, O Bhishma, are the cause of this entire war. When a king goes wrong, it is the duty of the minister to stop him from that wrong path. You never stop Dhritarashtra, and that is why you deserve to die. Seeing Krishna raise the weapon and charge toward him, Bhishma smiled. He was stunned and delighted at this marvelous sight. He was a Kshatriya. He did not have fear of death, but he had the joy of seeing how the Lord was protecting his devotee. And he put aside his bow and he said, "O Keshava, kill me if you will. To die at your hands is life's ultimate perfection." I tried my best to counsel Dhritarashtra, but the blind king was blinded by his attachment to his son Duryodhan, and he never listened to my counsel. While this conversation was going on, Krishna was charging across the field toward Bhishma. Normally, archery fights happen at a particular, at some distance from each other, unlike sword fights where the warriors are very close to each other. So Krishna could have hurled the wheel from wherever he was. When he uses his Sudarshan Chakra, he doesn't go close to his opponents. He just discharges his disc even from a far distance. Here, why did Krishna charge toward Bhishma? He was so anxious to make sure that the job was done, that the danger to Arjuna was ended, that he wanted to hurl the Sudarshan Chakra, the chakra, which was a substitute for the Sudarshan Chakra, from a close distance. Just like if we shoot from a close point, the chances of missing are less. So hurling the wheel from a close distance would mean the chances of hitting are more. And as Arjuna saw Krishna charging toward Bhishma with the wheel in hand, he felt dismayed. He knew what this action meant, that Krishna was breaking his vow, his word of honor for Arjuna's sake. Arjuna called out to Krishna, "Oh Krishna, please do not break your word." So important for the Kshatriyas was the word of honor that breaking it was almost unconscionable. Now, Dashrath Maharaj was ready to lose the association of his son and send him to the forest, although that son Ram was dearer to him than his own life, just because he had to honor the word that he had given. So that's how we can see how remarkable was Krishna's being ready to break his word of honor. And this is his love, but Arjuna's love was that he didn't want Krishna to be criticized, to be maligned for having failed to honor his word. And thus he called out, "Krishna, stop, please don't use weapons. I will fight wholeheartedly. I will kill Bhishma." But Krishna was so angry that he did not hear at all. Now, Krishna's anger is also an expression of love. If we are angry with someone, sometimes we may speak such harsh words that may break that other person's heart and it may damage that relationship irreparably. So even when we are angry, trying to speak politely is a sign of not just our self-control, but also is also a sign of our concern for the other person. A sign of our love for the other person, that we don't want to hurt their feelings, we don't want to hurt them, even if they have done something that is wrong or hurtful. So in some ways, restraining our anger is a sign of love. Simultaneously, expressing anger can also be a sign of love. Outrage is the special kind of anger which arises on seeing something unfair, something, as the word is, outrageous. So on seeing injustice, on seeing something which is iniquitous, if we don't feel anger, then there is something wrong with our conscience, something wrong with our moral sense. Often it is outrage that leads to reform or even revolution. bad things wouldn't change if some people didn't get worked up about how bad the things were and try to change them. So when a child is slightly mischievous, the parents may control their anger and not yell at the child, and that's how they show their love. But if the child is carelessly run into the middle of the road and has barely survived death, then the parents may speak strongly, may be angry with the child, and that anger needs to be seen as an expression of love. Because why would somebody get worked up so much unless they were invested in that? So Krishna's getting angry is a sign of his love for Arjuna. And here again we see the power of emotion being channeled. Devotion is all about channeling the power of emotion, and it is both the Lord's emotion for the devotee and the devotee's emotion for the Lord. So Arjuna's emotion was there of concern that Krishna never be maligned, that his honor not be impugned. And when Arjuna saw that Krishna was not hearing his words, Arjuna leapt off the chariot and started running after Krishna. And as he kept running, Krishna was charging ahead, and he was coming very close to Bhishma. So Arjuna leapt across the field and caught Krishna's thigh and held on to it. And yet Krishna was running with such force and momentum that Arjuna was dragged along by Krishna's running. And Arjuna was calling out to Krishna, yet Krishna didn't hear anything. Finally, Arjuna raised his feet high into the sky and high up and banged them down onto the ground. And those feet pierced into the ground, creating like a small trench, and his feet got stuck over there, and Arjuna was holding on to Krishna's thigh, and Krishna came to a stop. And Arjuna told Krishna, "Please don't fight, Krishna. I will fight tomorrow wholeheartedly, and I will defeat Bhishma. You please keep your word, I will keep my word." At the start of the war, Arjuna had said that he will take down Bhishma. Hearing Arjuna's words, Krishna calmed down. At this point, the whole nearby battle had stopped. So spectacular was the sight. Sometimes the word showstopper is used. Everybody stops doing everything. Something is so stunning, so show-stopping. So Krishna's charging towards Arjuna was a showstopper. In the middle of the battle, everybody had stopped to see what was this astonishing thing happening. And as Krishna and Arjuna turned back and walked toward the chariot, the sun went down in the horizon and the day's battle ended. So on this day was a dramatic event where Krishna's love for his devotee is seen through his anger. So we need to not curb the power of emotion, but channel the power of emotion. And we need to know that love can be seen both by restraining anger and expressing anger. Of course, the expression of anger has to be done in an appropriate way. And Krishna was ready to break his word of honor, but Arjuna did not want that to happen. Such is the amazing exchanges of love that happened between these three characters. It was Bhishma's love that made him fight so wholeheartedly. It was Arjuna's love for Bhishma that prevented him from fighting wholeheartedly. It was Krishna's love for Arjuna that made him want to fight. And it was Arjuna's love for Krishna that made him stop Krishna from fighting. And this is how, even on the war field, the deepest, warmest, and sweetest of loving exchanges occurred. Thank you. Hare Krishna.